Welcome to our video here at Christ Clarity Reassurance, where we provide reassurance as much as possible, coming from right advice from the Holy Spirit. This video, we are going to again cover the basic territory that we always cover with some interesting embellishments and clarifications. Today I received a clarification differentiating the third, the fourth, and the fifth dimensions. So let's look at that. Third dimension, let's look at it as space being viewed from the standpoint of form. Okay? Space being viewed from the standpoint of form. Fourth dimensional perspective is form being viewed from the standpoint of space. Form being viewed from the standpoint of space. In other words, 180 degrees opposite. Fifth dimensional standpoint is viewing space and form as a concurrent unity. Very different, huh? No duality there. Concurrent unity. Space and form is one unity. Okay, so there's a, you know, ka-ching, bingo, wow. There's a difference, isn't there? Third dimension, we view a space, all this space, in terms of form, from the perspective of form. Everything, all this form is here, and then space is, you know, between all these forms. Fourth dimension, it views form from the standpoint of space. So it's space with these forms within space, forms occupying a space, instead of space surrounding forms. It's now forms occupying space. And unity consciousness, fifth dimensional consciousness, is form, space, no division, no separation, no one viewing the other as primary. There is no primary, it's a unity. So you can see there's a huge difference. Huge, huge difference. Now, right now in the world, we have the fourth dimensional perspective is subjugating this planet. It's taking over from the third dimensional perspective. It's important to note that neither perspective is correct at all. Both are entirely dualistic, entirely deluded. And you can't say one is superior to the other. However, the fourth dimensional perspective tends to bring about high technology. And that enables a certain type of subjugation to take place, at least temporary, of third dimension. And so that's what's happened on the planet. That's what's happening. The heavy hand of the fourth dimension, of those who view form from the standpoint of space, they have taken over that perspective, has taken over the planet and holds the power structure now of this planet, and is weeding out all the third dimensional perspective. Because for the fourth dimensional perspective, it's just completely normal to space is primary and form is viewed from the standpoint of space. And of course now we have all these satellites, telescopes viewing out in space, viewing the Earth, looking back at the Earth, maps. You can go online, you see all these maps from up in the sky, and everything, all form is seen as occupying a great space. Space is being occupied. There's these forms in space, but space is the primary perspective. Whereas 3D sees all these forms, and happen to be surrounded by some space. That is why in 3D they would say, well, the Earth is the center of the universe. In other words, from the 3D perspective, where we're at is the center of the universe form-wise. And they even thought the sun, you know, revolved around the Earth and like that. And weren't really too concerned about what's out there. It's what's here. It's the planet is and the forms and everything. That is primary. Whereas the 4D, the technology enables them to travel throughout space, hyperdimensionally, and they see that it's space, that they, their perspective, it's space that is the great primary field, and there are these, you know, little bits of, you know, matter scattered out through space, and it's space that is primary. And so they, you know, flight, like, you know, the ability to fly is very important, developing faster and faster, better modes of flight through space, going through space to one place to the other, etc. That is 4D perspective, and that's what 4D emphasizes. And then all this high technology is actually a way of looking at form from the standpoint of space and punctuating space with all this digital, you know, information, etc. 3D doesn't develop a high technology. So, this is a very good way of looking at it. A very simple, great way of looking at it. I've been mostly, right now, I've been in more 3D, transiting to 5D consciousness. Have basically decided to forego the 4D. For instance, I don't fly at all. I don't fly. If I travel, I travel by car. I don't relate to space, the sky, the planets, all that kind of stuff. It just doesn't, you know, do anything at all for me. But so I understand that that is, it's a 3D perspective. However, it helps prevent the 4D detour, the 4D thing. I mean, if you start taking space as primary and looking at form from the standpoint of space, then you're going to be lost in that vast spatial perspective. You can just be lost for the longest time. It's very difficult to from that standpoint, to accept the unity of form and space, or of everything and nothing. That it's not one or the other. It's not even both. They're one. They're subject and object are one. Two sides of one coin. They're one. Our identity, that is our identity, is nothing and everything. Nothing and everything is our identity. Simultaneous, unified, nothing and everything. Where everything is exactly as it is within the awareness that is nothing. It's not awareness of something. It is just awareness, yet it is awareness in which everything arises. Everything. Not just anything specifically, but everything. So everything and nothing is our identity. The everything and nothingness of I am. You can say I am both and I am neither. In other words, it's a unity, a perfect unity. Now, at this very moment, all the television stations, internet, etc., is all obsessed, locked on to some severe weather in the Midwest, Oklahoma City, St. Louis, etc., all across the Midwest. And the radar and all this stuff, what is that? That's 4D, because it's talking about spatial things. The maps we're seeing the United States, we're seeing all the radar, the colors and everything, and et cetera, et cetera. That is from space, space looking at form, okay? So people are getting a very strong dosage of fourth dimensional perspective from these events. But more importantly than that, several days ago when I had this experience of like an enlightenment experience during a dream, my sleeping, and I asked Spirit, I was in Spirit, I asked Spirit, the Holy Spirit, how do we deal with this terrible problem in the world? Actually, the world is just a horrible, like, black hole, as it were. And the Holy Spirit said, you need to distance yourself from it. You need to distance yourself from it. And I said, wow, okay, how do we do that? So, the key advice is distancing ourselves from this world. Now, how do we do that? Now, if we can't right this moment do it spatially, like shift to another planet, which I believe in some ways going to be possible at some point. But up before that, how do we distance ourselves from this world? And of course, people have done that throughout history, is distancing themselves in some way. They withdraw, they retreat, go into meditation, etc. But right now, with all of this incredible media coverage, wall-to-wall media coverage of this, you know, heavy, severe weather in the Midwest, what am I doing here? I'm out in a beautiful, serene, calm place and doing this taping. I'm not watching this event, this extremely traumatic and fearful 4D coverage event. I'm not watching it. And I've consistently been this way almost my entire life, is the all this traumatic stuff, I don't watch it. I distance myself from it. So there's one example of how do we distance ourselves from this world. We make sure that we do not partake of the events of this world. We ignore the events of this world. That is one way to distance oneself. And I do a very good job of that. At the same time, I'm aware of at least some thin narrative of the world, but I keep my distance from it. Because it, in some way, it helps to reassure people that they think, oh, well, it's too difficult. If I'm aware of it, then I have to watch. And I say, that's not true. You can still realize that there's, you know, some thin narrative and back off of it and distance yourself from it. So the best way is don't watch television. You know, that's one of the best ways. Don't read the newspaper, don't watch television, don't listen, you know, the internet. Just don't pay any attention to the news. But then sometimes people feel they're too out of it about what's happening because all the friends know about it. So that is also very difficult. It's extraordinarily difficult now in the world because people don't share the spiritual values. They're intrigued by the fourth dimensional perspective. The fourth dimensional perspective has marketed itself in a way to catch people's imagination, fire people's imagination up. And so they don't share the objective of distancing themselves from the world, so you might feel isolated and alone if you're doing that. And so it's not easy at all. Frustratingly difficult. And it doesn't receive any cachet in the world. The fourth dimensionals don't even recognize such a thing. I mean, you're looking on like news, Yahoo News, and all the different sections, you know, world, local, science, technology, odd news, political news, etc. There's no spiritual news. There's no religious, spiritual. It's not even a category. Same on Google. It's not even a category. Very rarely on the internet will you see any category of spiritual, religious at all. It's as if it doesn't exist as an option. The fourth dimensionals think that their perspective is it. That's it. Just as the third dimensionals think their perspective is it too. Both think that their perspective is it, is the truth, and the way, and what is right. And they're polar opposites. You see a lot of people who are bipolar now, interestingly enough. They may be flipping-flopping between perspectives, third and fourth dimensional perspectives. Neither one is correct as far as our identity goes, as far as truth goes, reality. Reality is a perfect unity. Subject-object, perfect unity, so you can't even speak of subject-object, really. They're one, it's all one. But from our standpoint, we would say, you know, there's a pure awareness and then the experiencing that shows up in pure awareness. They're one. So it's one identity. So in distancing ourselves from the world, this is what we need to do. This is what I've been dedicated towards my entire life. How can I help the world, people, how can I help spirit distance itself from this world? From this world. Ultimately, it may end up being a spatial distancing. That's the sense I got when I received this information, this advice from Holy Spirit, that it seemed like a spatial distancing, actually going far away, you know, from this planet. Because the heavy hand is falling. There's no question about it. Anyone with half a little bit of intelligence it knows the heavy hand is falling upon this planet. It may be a velvet glove, but it's a heavy, heavy, heavy hand that is wrapped in a velvet glove. Soft tyranny can be very heavy indeed. It's often the worst kind, because it's so slick and you don't hardly know what's going on. It's hard to know until it's too late. It's like a translucent net instead of some heavy rope opaque net that you can see. This one's like translucent. You can't see. It's like nothing. You can already see it, and yet you can feel it. You can feel it. So people feel it. And so what we're doing here is we're practicing distancing ourselves from the world by focusing in on what really transcends what we call the world. What we call the world is our perspective of the world. Form itself, what we see, space, time, space, form, etc., in and of itself is just neutral. It doesn't have any purpose to it, really. But we give it purpose based on how we want to train, what kind of training. It's really just, symbols are just used for training. And the world is symbolic. The space and these forms are all symbolic for the purpose of training. And what spirit is doing is training itself, trying to train itself to die. So that's very simple, trying to train itself to die. That's why we have death. See, God didn't make death. There's no death in reality. This is a simulation, a training exercise in which forms, which are just symbols, die. And through this dying, spirit is like watching a movie, trying to get the sense of, okay, how do I die? You're watching all these bodies die, and spirit's watching me and says, huh, how are they doing that? You know, how are bodies managing to die? That's very interesting. I mean, I remember I used to feel that way. I was watching the world. I'd say, how in the world is everybody, how is this happening? It's a mystery. How is this happening? Weird. Still feel that way. I still don't understand aging or stuff dying or breaking. It seems to be like a bizarre mystery. I can't figure out how in the world is this possible. Well, it's possible because it's a dream. It's a simulation. It's a training exercise. So, part of the practicing, giving a new purpose to the world, a new training, is to begin to distance oneself from the training exercise. And of course, the more severe parts of the training exercise, even though it comes at us at all angles, some of these events on television and most of the programming on television is designed to hook us into this movie, this simulation, and for purposes of training. We need to get unhooked from it. So even though there's this frantic, super, seemingly interesting, compelling news, live, breaking news, live, triple supercell, you know, all this stuff. It's like, triple supercell, take cover now. You know, how can you not watch this? You know, they have live storm chasers and Doppler radar and you know, just everything. It's like you just want to sit there and watch it as you eat. You know, it's like a zombie watching this stuff. But I said, no. I turned it on, I looked at it and said, no. No way. Forget it. That's practicing. Attending satsang, inquiry, looking is practicing. Distancing oneself from the world is practicing. And without practice, we were paying attention to this training exercise, and that's not good. It's not good for us, because again, spirit is trying to learn how to die. So what do you think is going to happen in a training exercise designed to teach spirit how to die? Any possibilities? Anyone know? Of course, everything in this training exercise is going to die. It's all going to be vulnerable. It's all this dance of vulnerability, where everything is trying to avoid death, but it's right there, and at any moment you could slip, and that's it. That's the end. That's what this world is. And what spirit does with this training exercise, mind is presenting the training exercise for spirit. And what mind it does is it very ingenious the way it presents it. And it tries to make us quote unquote happy within this training exercise. It tries to have a happy training exercise. But that's only for the treachery to come and then to boom. Strike, sudden surprise, sudden trauma, sudden death. So that gives spirit feels this is a more helpful type of training, because spirit is blissful, perfectly happy. And spirit says, how can I kill this happiness? You know, I can't seem to kill it, it's still there. And so it sees these happy humans. And the spirit says, oh, there's someone else, there's some humans are happy. I see some happy humans. That's interesting. It's like me. It's kind of like what I am. You know, they're kind of similar, very happy and carefree. And let's watch these. What happens? Mind says, watch these humans. Watch. So spirit's paying attention. And then these happy humans are going along, and then suddenly, kaboom, you know, a twister comes and just obliterates their lives. And spirit's like, oh my gosh, wow, so that's how it's done. So maybe that could happen to me, spirit is saying. Maybe that could happen to my happiness. You know, so it's actually, it tells the truth, and that's what we do here. Mind is emphasizes happiness and contentment in this dream, in this simulation of loss. In fact, it places great emphasis on that, because it feels that this is more effective in teaching spirit, that if spirit can identify with humans that seem to be large and in charge, or anything in nature, large and in charge, and happy and carefree, the spirit will have a stronger identification with that. And so then that, at the height of happiness, suddenly kaboom, then spirit will say, oh my gosh, that can happen to me. And that's what spirit wants. It wants to feel like this can happen to me. I can be annihilated so that I can then be reborn, resurrected from the dead, and be the new prime creator of a new reality. So the way that I see it, the way that's been explained to me, is that all the effort to bring human happiness in the world, it's all part of this setup, this play of mind, so that spirit continues to engage with this simulation, this training exercise. Because spirit doesn't have to engage, it can just say, I'm going to choose a different training exercise. This one, the simulation of no loss, no loss at all. And that reminds me of reality, and then I set down all simulations altogether. So spirit could easily do that. So mind is saying, hey, no, spirit, don't do that. I have a more effective training tool for you. And spirit says, really? All the other ones didn't work. And mind says, oh yeah, this one will work. So here's another thing I'm going to say, flat out, straight out. All the gods and goddesses in training, wannabe gods and goddesses in training, are all frauds, are completely fraudulent, 100% fraudulent. What their purpose is actually to attract to them a nexus of happiness and contentment and fulfillment of human form. The same way a farmer wants to raise very fat, plump, contented cattle. Okay, the farmer might invest a lot of time and effort and concern and love in their cattle, giving them, treating them for illnesses, repairing their injuries, feeding them the best food, grooming them, taking care of everything of the cattle. The cattle think, my gosh, the farmer just loves us. This is a love affair. And then one day, the farmer sells the cattle, you see, to the slaughter yard, and the cows are marched on in the cattle cars, and the farmer makes a great profit. And the cattle say, well, how could this possibly happen? Okay. Same way that the gods and goddesses in training, meaning those aspects of this simulation that are put highlighted as if they're close to understanding how to die and how to then to be resurrected as a new prime creator, those that seem to have this specialness about them attract and try to build up happy, contented, fulfilled humans, people, forms, etc. around them, like a kingdom, a little mini principality, as it were, principalities. And that is all for the purpose so that the slaughter of then those that are, they've been attracted to this god or goddess in training will seem all the more shocking and all the more surprising and all the more plausible to spirit, all the more plausible. So this is a very harsh truth, a very disillusioning fact that I'm telling you, sharing with you. It a couple days now I've been seeing this super clearly, and it's kind of depressing. I've kind of been down, really actually almost suicidal at times, just feeling, my gosh, this is just horrible. The whole existence is just nothing but deception. And even the good stuff is deception. You know, that's the hard part. Is, you know, it's just like the cattle think they found nirvana. This wonderful farmer takes care of it, helps them so much, and then sells them to slaughter. That's how existence is. Existence is trying to raise up consciousness to certain type of contentment, happiness, fulfillment, thinking, oh, I finally got it made. This is wonderful. So then at that point, it can be slammed down into annihilation. So that spirit will keep watching this movie and saying, oh, this is a good part. This might help. This might be it for me. I can finally get it now. Because here's something that really seemed like spirit, and now it's been annihilated just suddenly, like so drastically horrible. And spirit will say, okay, maybe I can do that. So this is how I have seen it. And not only that, I've lived it. I've lived through all of this. Very upsetting, really, because these gods and goddesses in training, whose job is to seduce us, spiritually seduce us, and fatten us up for the slaughter, they recruit people to help them do this, okay? And part of that recruitment is to provide entertainment and various, very attractive stuff that attract people and try to make them feel like, oh, this is so wonderful, that kind of thing. So I was recruited for this, and I've had a very tempestuous, conflictual relationship with that, because you want to help people, make them feel better, but you don't quite realize you're just being used to attract people into this principality, so that they into a state of mind that they think that, oh, everything is so wonderful. Flowers everywhere, beautiful music, lovely people, everybody saying the right spiritual things. I was also recruited to try and give a right, I was supposed to give spiritual music, very high, beautiful spiritual music, and the ability to weave in all sorts of spiritual themes in the music. So I had to study all sorts of spirituality, and I tried to do all this, but in the back of my mind I said, there's something strange about this. I'm uneasy, very much uneasy about it. So I began to really delve into this whole situation in depth, and I'm finally able to see it. It's treachery, it's absolute treachery. The gods and goddesses in training are completely treacherous. They're frauds, absolute frauds. And they will recruit those who are most talented to try, it's like setting up a court, like you have the royals, and the royals want to set up this incredible court with people with the best wit, the best poetry, the best music, the most beautiful people, high culture, everything, the best food, every the most beautiful gardens, the most beautiful estate, everything to make people think, oh, this is like almost like heaven. I'm in heaven. This is just wonderful. What a great, great place. And when people are feeling like this is just like paradise, suddenly the invaders come sweeping through and butcher everybody. This is history. This is history. This is why history is the way that it is. It's all a setup. Existence is a setup. And when you see this, it's very disillusioning. And you know, you can be down for a little while, kind of feeling like, God, just, I was down. Even after all these years of being disillusioned, I was still seeing it, just how utterly treacherous it is. You can be recruited from someone you think is like a goddess, is like, this is right closest to God as imaginable, just, and you think, couldn't possibly lie, they couldn't possibly deceive, they couldn't possibly be using me. Stuff turns out they are. Turns out that's all they're doing, because they themselves think that they're the ones who are going to learn how to die. So they want to view this, they want to view your death and your destruction, all the slaughter, so they can become, they can know, learn how to die to what they are, so they can be reborn as prime creators. So they're just using these gods and goddesses and training, are just using everyone for the slaughter, for their own attempts to learn how to die, so they can be reborn, resurrected from annihilation, and then therefore be prime creator, a prime creator. So that's unfortunately what I have lived through, what I have seen, and they're utterly shameless. They're utterly shameless, completely shameless. They will tell any lie, any deception, and they can make their situation seem very beautiful, because they recruited, you know, the best interior decorators, the best designers, the best florists, the best this. People are super talented. They're told that they are helping lift humanity up, and this like a spiritual retreat. Everything is so wonderful, and they're helping save everyone. They're fattening the cattle up for the slaughter. So I've been horrified to see this. Unfortunately, I was ineffective in what I was doing, because I had reservations and doubts, and the gods and goddesses in training kept telling that they're going to help me. Every step of the way, they said, we're going to help you, we're going to help you, help us on his way, etc. They never helped at all. It was all on my shoulders, and they exploited me entirely. Financially, my time, my effort, everything, completely exploited me and never gave me anything. Because you have to sell out entirely. You have to sell out. They're looking for those who are willing to sell out. All sell out entirely. And of course, those who are willing to sell out, then they get all these perks. They get the fame, the fortune. And they get all the drugs, and these gods and goddesses they set up their situation to keep everybody kind of satiated in a sensual way. There's a sensual satiation going on there. Whatever you want from the standpoint of drugs and sensual stimulation, etc., is available to those who are providing the quote unquote attractive high culture to that principality. So it's very seductive. Those gods and goddesses are super seductive in how they offer you everything you could possibly want. You think you can spend all your time composing the most sacred music, and then providing these big performances, and all this. It seems like your creativity is just like totally supported. In other words, like they're patrons of your creativity. And then also you can have any sort of sensual delights that you want. So there's a whole division of their scheme that uses people sensually, like that. They're, like they're sex slaves, prostitutes, and all of that is part of the whole thing, actually. And so is the drugs and the food and all this kind of stuff. They have the finest, you know, finest in all of that. The finest in wine, women, and song, whatever it takes for these super creative people to weave this magical mirage of happiness. So that then the slaughter, destruction can happen, and the god and goddess, the goddess and god in training can view that and say, ah, okay, so this is how spirit can die. I think this is very helpful. So existence is absolutely teeming with all of that. That's the scheme, that's the game. And when you have this creativity, you want an outlet for it, you want people to benefit from it, so you become a sucker for all of this. You're a sucker for all of this. And again, you might work, you know, 16 hours a day, be driven like a crazy to produce this constant production of more and more material, fresh material, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You don't have any time for anything else, really. But then you're told, if you want to take a break, here's a companion for you. It's like escorts, companions, just provided for you like that. Whatever you want, you can choose among, you know, hundreds of escorts or companions. And then you get right back to work. You know, you get right back to work, and you're producing this mirage, like a mirage, a paradise mirage to get people buy into it. The whole thing is to get people to buy into it, so that then when the catastrophe happens, they're utterly taken by surprise and shock. Because you see, spirit again can't die. It's impossible. But it says, well, it just doesn't know how. And since it can't see any way possible, it says, well, it must be a surprise. It must be a total surprise. It'll catch me completely by surprise. So it focuses in on being taken by surprise in the simulation. It really tries to build up situations where someone is taken by surprise. Shocking thing. And then spirit says, okay, that seems very realistic. That's probably what's going to happen to me. It's going to happen just out of the blue. So I'll be super happy and blissful, not a care in the world, and suddenly, boom, I'm annihilated. So it loves that type of simulation, and it pursues that with all these quote-unquote gods and goddesses in training. Those are just devices, like the stars and starlets attracting an audience. You know, all the right lighting is on them. All the mood music is perfect. The costumes are perfect. All this stuff. That's all part of existence. That's how it works. A lot of production value. Whoever can give the most production value is recruited. And because I had great capabilities in music, composition, performance, all that kind of stuff, I was able to give super production value, had the capability. I was heavily, heavily recruited. So I know about this stuff. And, you know, they're not happy that I'm, you know, say no. They're still trying to, you know, trying to hopefully recruit. And at the same time, and if they can't succeed at that, to shut me up, actually. So existence is worse than we realize. Way, way worse, way more treacherous. You might say it's entirely treacherous. Which, of course, is a very depressing thought. It's really very depressing. So we tend not to dwell on that. Or we can be aware of it, but then we say, I don't want to think about that. But for me, I say, well, how do we distance ourselves from this? Specifically, for instance, a specific training exercise, like the tornadoes or something, then the world itself is a collective training exercise. How do we distance ourselves from that? And ultimately, how do we distance ourselves from the entire training exercise, which is to choose a new idea, exchange the simulation of loss for the simulation of no loss. That is how it's done. That is how it's done. So it definitely is a way. The disillusionment, it wears off. I mean, I feel okay now, but yesterday I was very down. I did a video yesterday, and it failed to I put it through the YouTube video editor. It failed to publish. Amazing. Failed to publish. I have no idea why. Maybe because I was so down. Maybe somehow Holy Spirit blocked it in some way that wouldn't go through. And maybe he said, wait until today. I feel a lot better. And it was one thing after the other, and I began to see the entire treachery of the whole situation. I just like, wow, one after the other. I was like, huh, wow, whew, wow, that's amazing. Very strong, very strong. Actually, it was 2 days of disillusionment. I did the video 2 days ago. That would be on a Wednesday. And then that was severe disillusionment on Wednesday. It continued on Thursday. And then today, Friday, I seem to be bouncing back a bit from that. The dreams have been horrible, horrible dreams, my God. Huh. I came across one of these gods and goddesses in training in a dream. And I experienced kowtowing to them. I was intimidated by them. And they were like some super creative person. They were just organizing all this creativity, pushing all these buttons and stuff. And it's like, wow, very intense dream. And then last night I had, an extraordinarily unwelcome, intense dream where there was I was aware of an attempt to shut me up and keep me from talking about this stuff. It was being done in a psychic manner, very devious manner. The fourth dimensionals are very devious. And the world is controlled by the fourth dimensionals right now. And they were trying to get me to use my own mind to make myself sick. What it was, just to give you the example of how devious the fourth dimensionals are, they work psychically. And I was told to go into the doctor. I had to go in the doctor, and the doctor said something really important. The doctor had some message for me, super important. It was a female doctor. It was an Indian from India, female doctor from India. And she said, I gotta tell you, it's very, very important. You have severe cancer in your larynx, which is the vocal box, right? And we have to do immediate surgery. You gotta take it out. I mean, it's very aggressive, very bad. And I said, what are you talking about? I don't know. I feel fine. You know, I don't feel anything wrong with me. She said, no. You have severe. And she was insistent that I had severe cancer. And I told her, well, where's your proof? And then she. I said, I've never taken any tests. How do you know? And she says, no, we have all the tests on you. I said, really? Let me see. And she produced all this paperwork and all these, you know, tests and then showed all the values. Then she explained, see, your value here, super cancerous. She says, all the signs, you have super bad cancer. And I said, yeah, but I never took any such test. Where did you get my blood? Where did you get these test results? I've never taken any tests at all. And she says, no, that we have the evidence. You have to go into surgery right away. We've got to set it up. There's no time to lose. You must do it. Super insistent. And of course, I go into surgery. They're going to cut my larynx out, and I can't talk anymore. You see what I'm saying? So what's going on is, psychically, there's this attempt for me to believe that I do have cancer of the larynx. So that if I believe it, then my mind will actually bring it about. You see, if I believe that what the doctors told me, I definitely have it, very aggressive, my mind will start thinking, fear will bring that form into my larynx. It's a psychic attack, very vicious psychic attack. And I've been under attack from fourth dimensionals my entire life, as a matter of fact. A lot of it from India. Most of the attack I've been under is from India. India has a level of fourth dimensionality to it, very strong. Which is why almost a large percentage of the software, all the software, you know, a large percent of that in the world that all the computers are running on, have been coded by Indians. It's very fourth dimensional. Indians can be very fourth dimensional. They see form from the standpoint of space. Some of them, there's a whole level of that. And I've been under psychic attack from them my entire life. Very severe. Very severe. And they're very arrogant. Very much spiritual imperialists, the fourth dimensionals. In my case, the Indians, but all fourth dimensionals are very arrogant and feel spiritually imperialist, spiritual imperialists, I call them. That feel, they want to colonize you, you know. You become part of their empire, their psychic empire, and what they want to do, they want to raise you up so you're good fat little cattle, so they can be slaughtered. That's what they want to do. So I was in this super intense encounter with this Indian female doctor, MD, and her cohorts, and they were insisting that I had super bad aggressive cancer. We had to do immediate surgery, otherwise I was going to die. And so imagine a dream like that, and I had to be in this intense disagreement with them and keep telling them, no, I do not have it. I don't care what your results say. You didn't get those results from me, you know. But imagine that kind of attack on you. If you don't have the strength to deal with that, you will say, oh my gosh, you start freaking out and you see the results and you say, oh my gosh, I do have it. Okay, what do I do, And, you know, and then you start getting your complete, you believe it so strongly, it'll actually manifest in you. It'll actually manifest in you. So this is the type of skullduggery that is taking place in the world. And I know that some of you watching this can relate to what I'm saying very well. You're very much in tune with this kind of stuff of the skullduggery is very subtle, very tricky from the fourth dimensionals. They try to get you to cause your own demise. That is their thing. They'll suggest that you're going to have an accident, for instance, and they'll do all this stuff, and then they also say that they're here to help you to spiritually raise you up. And the problem with the Indians is that they're very, very adept. The fourth dimensional Indians are very adept at giving the pseudo spirituality. Very good at it, you know. And I've been fighting that my entire life because you have to get free of that. You know, they have to get free of it. And to some extent I have, because the teaching I've given out is way superior to anything they have, basically. And you know, that they will want you to think, well, we're saying the same thing as Ramana or Anandamayima or some one of their, you know, one of the big gurus. First of all, Anandamayima never identified with her physical body, not for an instant, and she explicitly said that. Therefore, she wasn't an Indian. You see, very important to understand, she was not an Indian. Neither was Ramana Maharshi, he was not an Indian. The body happened to be born in India, largely because there's a tremendous amount of population in India and a whole network of spiritual focus there. And so it would disseminate, you know, maybe best there. But if spirit comes into the world to share with truth, and they don't identify with their body at all, how can anyone claim that they are that ethnicity? Totally false. They are not any ethnicity at all. Spirit has no ethnicity to it, none. Has no form to it. It's formless. It's simultaneously no form and all form. So it doesn't have any ethnicity to it. Ethnicity, none, 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 none. And yet the Anandamayima was under constant assault to try and get her to push the spiritual agenda of Bharat of India. It's a fourth dimensional push to provide a one world religion for the planet, and India was supposed to provide this one world religion, and they wanted to put her as the figurehead of this one world religion, and she refused. Gandhi, Mahatma Gandhi, tried everything he could to get her to do that, and a lot of gurus and movers and shakers behind the scene of the fourth dimensionals tried to get her to agree to this, and she absolutely refused. This is not even a thought of doing such a thing. This is completely out of the question. She wasn't an Indian. She was everything and nothing simultaneously. That's spirit. She was spirit. And not even a she. It was spirit there. Anandamayima, it was spirit. Not she. There's no she there. There's no he. There's no she. It's it. It's nothing and everything simultaneously there. So the idea that India has some sort of spiritual mandate or something to control the planet spiritually and provide the right spiritual teaching of the planet is absolute nonsense. Total nonsense. As a matter of fact, that most of the gurus in India are complete frauds, totally fraudulent. That's a fact. And they're very, very bad rascals, as a matter of fact. They're wannabes, gods and goddesses, wannabes. Okay, most of them, not all. There's some great spiritual people in India, as a matter of fact. Maybe more there than any place in the world, but you often don't even know who they are. And there's some jewels there for sure that have realized the truth that they are spirit. But most of the teachers and the gurus and the goddesses and gods, all that stuff in India is fraudulent, totally fraudulent, very bad stuff. And there is this massive agenda of trying to indoctrinate the world into a one world religion, that and Indians feel that they have the right to do this. Because why? Because Shankara happened to be born there, or Anandamayi Maa happened to be born there. So that has nothing, that doesn't give any them a mandate for anything. The very fact that they think they need to rule the planet shows that they're completely ignorant. They have no idea what liberation salvation is. It's just like Jesus was not a Jew, was not a Gentile, was spirit. Nobody can claim Jesus from a standpoint of ethnicity. No way. Same with Buddha. No one can claim ethnicity with Buddha. Shankara, same thing. They never identify with the body. Never. And of course, people who want to use them for the purpose of world domination insist that they identify with a body, meaning they identify with an ethnicity. You know, and then they claim that they're special. Because of that, oh God, Son of God, Spirit came down and identified with our ethnicity. So we're special. We have a right to rule the world. Okay. And you get this from different angles. Different people throughout history have, you know, you see it all over the place. It's not just the Indians, it's other groups too, and you know very well the various groups that do this. And it continues on and on. Again, Spirit is nothing and everything, a unity of nothing and everything. It has no specialness whatsoever. And the spirit appearing to animate a body in this world does not identify with that body at all. Not at all. But of course, since they have a body, people will say, well, they're male, they're female, they have ethnicity, etc. They were born in this country. And so they think that this somehow means their country is some great place, and that ethnicity, and that gender, all this kind of nonsense. It's total nonsense. And then they use that to perpetrate a fraud, you know, perpetrate a fraud on everybody, and try to get them to capitulate. To their fraud, which is again to build up sacrifice. That's what it, you know, happy sacrifice, unaware surprise sacrifice. That's what they're into. That's what the world is into. The world is into sacrifice. Period. That's the business of existence is sacrifice. Purpose of existence is sacrifice. Purpose is to teach spirit how to die. That is the purpose. So, I mean, I'm not mad at anybody, but I'm speaking truth to authority. I'm speaking truth to the situation. Nobody's going to get me down for long, you know. I don't appreciate those types of things that try to silence me, you know. Don't appreciate it. And I'm aware of it. In the area I live, it's a Silicon Valley. It is saturated with high level fourth dimensional Indians and people from all the world, but a ton of Indians. I asked someone recently who's been living here their whole life, and he said, I go out on a walk, everybody I meet is from India. Everybody. It's a super rich area. Everybody. He says, well, 90%, he said. It's all, they've bought up the whole area. They're saturating the area. You know, very high and powerful fourth dimensional minds, perspectives. Are absolutely saturated this area. So I'd really like to get out of this area, as a matter of fact. I think for my own well-being, it would be a very good idea to distance myself from the Silicon Valley, and I very much want to do that. And it won't be a minute too soon when it happens, you know? Someone said, go to Missouri. I got a dream, said Missouri or something. Well, maybe, I don't know. My parents and my grandparents' parents on my dad's side were from Missouri. But, you know, I do need to get out of this Silicon Valley, because this fourth dimensional mindset is just absolutely thick as molasses here. It's very interesting, too, symbolically. We've had this horrible invasion of ants, little black ants that are very subtle, tricky. We can't prevent them. They are invading our house. Every morning, there's trails and trails of ants. Just, you know, if you leave the slightest crumb anywhere, the ants come in, and just massive amounts of ants. They come in after the cat food. They come in after everything. It's just a nightmare. And then out in the yard, the yard is absolutely saturated with these little black ants. Very subtle, and it's hard to keep them out, because you can caulk everywhere, but the tiniest little crack somewhere, they can get through it. So there's and this is all over the area. It's just been the last like 5 years. Suddenly, these ant colonies are everywhere. Black ants, and then crows. An invasion of crows. The amount of crows now is just unbelievable. There's some flocks up there. Just like must have been 50 or more, they're just creating terrible, terrible racket. And of course, they're voracious and very shrewd and clever, these crows. And I link that with it's very symbolic, very symbolic. For me, fourth dimensional Indians in this area are just super powerful now, super powerful. And they don't like what I have to say, apparently. They never have, because they've been after me my entire life, as a matter of fact, to silence me. And they've used every trick in the book to derail what I have to say here. Because again, they see their salvation as witnessing the sacrifice of others, so they can learn how to kill their own spirit. And then they believe if they can learn how to do that, they will then automatically be resurrected, because that shows they have a power that's greater than God's, because God created spirit. And so if spirit can find a way to destroy what God created, spirit assumes that this means the spirit is more powerful than God. And therefore, this power will then resurrect spirit from its annihilation. And spirit will then be prime creator. So you may be under pressure from another type of fourth dimensional. I just happen to mention what I'm under severe pressure from, have been. They used the symbol of Ananda Maima to trick me, you see. And so I've had to dig out from that one. That's a tough one, because they claim they're doing this in her name, that this is what she wanted to do, and this is, you know, she's behind it all. Not true. She's not behind any of that. But you think that you're helping her out. I said, oh, I have a chance to help Ananda Maima out. But it was really the Indians are trying to get me to help them out, take over this area. Fourth dimensionally, and set it up as like a principality here, a kingdom with super high spiritual music, like an ashram, like a very high, beautiful ashram, with me being in charge of a lot of the high spiritual stuff, the music, the whole music director of this whole, you know, principality. And I'm certainly capable of it, but I also, you know, saw through a lot of it, saying there's something very fishy going on here, very fishy. And yet they presented it as if it was I was doing it for Ananda Maima, you see, and that she was actually going to return to the world and set up residency in this principality that once we set it up, which is, you know, so how do you say, oh, no, I won't do that? You think you're doing the highest service to the world in setting it up, but it was all a fraud. It was a total fraud. They were trying to get me to set this up, be musical director, spiritual director, of a large area, not just like a small ashram, but an entire area, principality here, of high level fourth dimensional Indians and other, but they'd be mainly in charge actually. And they were just doing it for themselves. They were using me for their own greed and power. And the story they told me was I was preparing it for Ananda Maima, but I was really preparing it for them, you see. So they were liars. Total liars. But it's super difficult when you get the way they presented it. You know, I thought like I was doing it for an on my mind. They convinced me of that. So they're very clever, very treacherous, very devious liars and frauds. And so they're being, I'm outing them. Why not? We have to do that. We have to distance ourselves from that. The spiritual musical director in a very prominent, important place in a principality where Ananda Mayamwa was going to come and spread enlightenment throughout the world. Imagine the temptation of that, which is what I've literally been through. I composed many, 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 many songs. I didn't record them, actually, because I started to feel like there's something's not right here. You know, it's like, wow, wait a minute. Ran out of money, too. They bloodsuckers. They suck you dry. They make you charge everything. Get as many credit cards as possible, charge everything, run up huge debts, etc. And they promise that you're going to be paid tenfold back, and you don't get a penny. You don't get a penny. So you end up with just, totally submerged in impossible debt. You're wiped out. That's also what they do. They had me do all of that. I was supposed to provide a model for all this. I provide a perfect model that then others could copy the model. And so I had to, provide like this, like an ashram. Like I had to set up a beautiful ashram with beautiful music, and I did all of that. I did everything requested, but then nothing happened, and I realized that there was something malevolent present in some way. I just couldn't figure out, how devious they really were. It's hard to imagine how devious they are. Hey, very good. Like look at Sai Baba, for instance. The recent one, how devious he was, just fooled so many people, so many, many, many people. And the India's full of these devious gurus who deceive so many, so many, so many. Baba Muktananda, then Adida Samraj got all that from India and brought it over, all that deception, the Shakti deception, and then deceived a lot of people. Set up his own principality, etc. But it's just India produces so much of that, and they export it. They've exported it around the world and used the West so badly. They've used the West super badly because we're naive. We're naive. We're trusting. We're not up to speed on all the spiritual deception that they've been practicing for thousands of years, and they're very good at it. The dark masters, all right, very, very tricky at it. So they can talk a good game, and they can make it seem like they're wonderful, and you get pulled into service to that. And so they used all these Westerners all over the world, deceived them, duped them into spreading this power structure, this fourth dimensional power structure throughout the world. And I had an Indian come here to my house and try to recruit me just recently. It was terrible. And they gave all this spiritual BS, to me. Like there's all this new age, blah, 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 blah. They had it down. Right away I said, ah, what a deceiver. What a deceiver. What a deceiver. So, the world has been deceived, very badly deceived. And then you have the third dimensional fundamentalists, who are just, agitated and angry at what's happening. But they don't quite, they know it, they hate the fourth dimensionals, and they don't want any of it. But they themselves are deluded, severely deluded as well. They believe in sacrifice too. I mean, they believe that God actually, since it's like they believe that spirit can't kill itself, and God took so much pity on spirits. Oh, spirit, you've tried for so long to kill yourself. I feel so sorry for you. But you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to kill you myself, and then and in doing so, then you will be resurrected as a new spirit, and you can be prime creator then. So they believe that to a large extent. A lot of that stuff. God did it. God killed spirit, which is utter nonsense. So they have their own demons to deal with, but they have a hard time dealing with fourth dimensional treachery. So many people have been picked off by that now, and they've been pulled into this notion that they're producing a golden age, that they're bringing the world up. You know, the stock market's soaring, 15,000, everything's, gosh, it's good times are bad, and we're headed toward a golden age now. And people have been sucked into this massive 4D bureaucracy of producing the utopia here. But again, it's treachery. It's all fraudulent, it's all treachery. It's designed, again, for catastrophe to have sudden, boom, collapse. Sudden collapse. And that's what mind is presenting for spirit, because that's what spirit seems more compelling to spirit, more believable, more plausible to spirit. Because again, spirit can't see any possible way that it can die. It doesn't know where can it come from. It's like total mystery, because it can't come from anywhere. Spirit cannot die. Spirit's completely invulnerable. Spirit didn't create itself. God created spirit. God created spirit, eternal life. There's no loss whatsoever. Spirit can't lose anything. So spirit's wondering, how in the world can I die? And so it has to watch a movie of treachery, 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 treachery. And so, of course, in the movie, there are these very treacherous beings, actors, actresses. I don't know who's more treacherous. They're both extraordinarily treacherous, these actors and actresses. Pick your poison, as it were. So people have been pulled into this so much around the world. They think they're doing good. They think they're on the spiritual path. They think they're on the path to enlightenment, path to salvation, etc., etc. And they are not. They're just hookers. You know, they're hooking people into treachery, spiritual whores, I call them. You know, they're really spiritual whores, that they, you know, whores and pimps of hooking people into this false scenario, this mirage, so that then catastrophe and destruction can come upon what's a seeming ideal situation and bring it crashing down. So this is unfortunately hard-earned awareness and recognition, brutally hard-earned stuff, just absolutely terrible. The way that the simple, the fact that they don't really care about you at all, that what they're really after is your death. You just can't believe it. You know, you just can't believe it. And that they're willing to say they're doing this in the name of Jesus or in the name of Ananda Mayamar and make it seem like you're helping them, whereas all they're really after is your death. It just is so difficult to believe that. You can't hardly believe that, really. But it's true. And we're complicit in it because we're after the same thing. We're trying to figure out how we can be prime creator, how we can die. So we think that we're no better than these treacherous wannabe God and Goddess wannabes, really. Yeah, we have to be humble and repent enough to see that we're using them too. We're using them too. We think that if they find a way, that means we'll know the way too. And so maybe we can blame it on them, you know, blame it on Sai Baba, you know, he's the blame or something. But it's the ones that are following, they're actually the treacherous too. You know, they just think that they're going to outsmart and they'll get the answer, you know, that kind of thing. So we all have to repent. Let's not scapegoat. But it is important to see the dynamic there. It is important to see the dynamic there. And, a lot of people spoke up over the last 30 years. A lot of people, and I paid attention to them. Thank you, everybody that's spoken up. Big help, big help, big help. Right now, there's not so much talk about it. Not so much talk about it. Because the game is so far advanced now that people are really intimidated. The heavy hand is upon us now. But those who can speak up should speak up. And so that's what I'm doing here. And it's important to note that just because there is all this treachery, etc., doesn't mean everything is treacherous. The Holy Spirit is not treacherous. God is not treacherous. Truth is not treacherous. just because we set up trying to set up a false utopia doesn't mean there isn't some actual utopia, some actual paradise in the fifth dimension. I had this guided imagery thing of like remote viewing, sort of seeing the future, and I saw this beautiful woman, like a goddess in training, in this beautiful blue gown, and she was so spiritual. She looked like the Virgin Mary or something. She was trying to imitate a Virgin Mary appearance or something. She seemed so spiritual, and she was leading all these people into this beautiful lagoon, this warm water lagoon, and everybody was going, following her. And she led them into this lagoon, and everybody thought that they were there to set up a kingdom with her and worship her and be enlightened by her and all this stuff. And then suddenly, what I saw was, in this lagoon, all these huge crocodiles suddenly came in and absolutely ate everybody, tore them to pieces and devoured them all. And then she was watching all this, you see. She was watching all this. And she was trying to learn how to annihilate her spirit by watching all these people that she had led into this lagoon be eaten alive by crocodiles. And I saw that, and I said, oh my gosh. And I knew it was legit, but it was so hard to believe that somebody that was posing as a goddess, a spiritual goddess, would be so treacherous. But literally, that's what they're up to. They think that they need to witness the most treacherous kind of death, where people were like almost in spirit, you know, almost in nirvana, and worshiping this spiritual being they thought was like God or goddess, and then be suddenly just completely devoured in the most horrible way. That then they think that then this can teach their spirit how to die. And of course it can't. Spirit cannot die. So it's utterly futile. This stuff is completely futile that they're doing. But this is the kind of stuff that goes on. Now, you see all these movies, the reptilians and stuff, the flying reptilians and with horrible claws and just terrible, you know, vicious predatory kind of creatures and flying around stuff, and we think, oh, these people are just making all this, you know, this nice imagination. No, it's not. This is actually memories that these people have, beings have, that are making these movies and watching them. Memories of planets that they've lived on where this is what happens. So they are sort of putting together these movies to just kind of like remind themselves, you know, to of what it was that they've been through, that they like reviewing it, kind of like hindsight, where it's not so traumatic. They're seeing it on a movie screen. But there absolutely are planets where there are flying reptilian kind of bird-like creatures that attack. There's absolutely, the universe is attack. It's all over there. There's predatory attacks. Again, because that's the purpose of the universe, is for spirit, is a training exercise, a simulation of loss for spirit to learn how to be destroyed, annihilated. So all the stuff you see in movies, that takes place in the universe. Those kind of things do take place. It's terrible attacks and stuff. Yeah, so it's not a joke. It is not a joke. And you have to be careful what you get attached to. And I always say clarity is the best thing, as far as your own clarity, your own disillusionment is what truth is, what you need to be attached to. Don't get attached to these gurus. Even the legit ones, don't get attached, because they will most definitely be used by the deceivers to make you think that all the preparations you're doing are being done for them, for these legit teachers. I mean, Jesus has been used that way for 2,000 years, that everybody thinks that they're preparing for Jesus, and they're just preparing, they're just helping the deceivers out. So what you need to pay attention to is the Holy Spirit. That's what Jesus said. When Jesus was leaving, they said, why are you leaving us? He said, I need to. It's better that I go. It's better for you that I go. And in my place, I will send you the great comforter and the Holy Spirit, which will explain everything to you. And that's exactly right. Otherwise, people would try to get attached to this appearance of a body, and that brings about all sorts of troubles, actually. And they get vulnerable to deception, whereas if you just try to follow the Holy Spirit and its clarifications, you're not as vulnerable. That's the only reason I'm able to say these things now, is the Holy Spirit has clarified it for me. But I was really very confused and puzzled by the deception. I just couldn't believe anyone was so devious to accuse Ananda Mayama as a cover for what they're doing and hold her up and try to convince that was what you're working for. Absolutely shameless. I mean, I can't believe that someone would have no shame in that way. Hard for me to believe. You know, this. I feel that some things are sacred, and you just don't do that. But these fourth dimensional entities' perspective, they have no shame about that. They absolutely will use it in that way to deceive you. You know, there's no conscience, no shame, nothing sacred to them, nothing sacred. Their success is sacred. The end justifies the means for them. So, you know, nothing is off limits for them to use as a prop to deceive. Nothing. It's difficult to deal with that. Very difficult. So I've been working through all that kind of stuff. And everybody in the world is deceived in some way. So you have to work through it and get clarification and listen to the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit gives you advice, you know, it somehow the Holy Spirit will work you through it if you just hang in there. And the Holy Spirit told me right. I did this archiving project of all the photos of Ananda Mayama. And I was told I was supposed to help spread those all over the world. So I'm responsible for a lot of that. And the Holy Spirit told me, don't do it, don't do it. You're gonna be great, big trouble. You're gonna really regret it, it's severe trouble. Distance yourself from that. The Holy Spirit told me, distance yourself from that. And I said, how are you talking about? How could that possibly be wrong? And the Holy Spirit says, listen, just trust me, stay away from it. Now I see it's being used by the fourth dimensionals to deceive. It absolutely is. The Holy Spirit is higher than any guru, okay? It's higher than Jesus, it's higher than Ananda Mayama, it's higher than Ramana Maharshi, it's higher than Buddha, higher than Muhammad, higher than any appearance in this world. The Holy Spirit is higher. Because the Holy Spirit is directly informing us about God without any distortion whatsoever. It's the real guru, okay? So, make the Holy Spirit your guru. That is the answer. Not Ananda Mayama, not Ramana, no, they're not my gurus. And to her credit, Ananda Mayama said, I'm nobody's guru. Now, she was legit, absolutely legit. But she said, I'm nobody's guru. Absolutely not. I'm just a crazy little girl here. That's it. And I don't identify with this body in the slightest bit. Don't make me a guru, she said. And yet, it's very difficult not to. So, unfortunately, I ended up getting deceived, very badly deceived. And that's caused me extraordinarily extreme problems in my life. But I can't blame her. But in the same time, you know, gurus coming in the world certainly give the deceivers something to work with, too. It does work that way. It works, you know, both ways. It works both ways. So, the Holy Spirit is the guru. If you accept that and keep working with that, you will work your way out of the deception. You will work your way out because the fourth dimensionals then cannot use any form, you know, to trick you. They can't use any form to trick you. So again, the Holy Spirit is my guru. The Holy Spirit is my guru. It's not even Jesus. Not even Jesus. It's the Holy Spirit. It's not even the Ananda Mayama. Nope, she's not my guru. Holy Spirit is my guru. And again, the all those gods and goddesses, wannabes in training, are frauds, absolutely treacherous frauds. Don't make them your gurus. I don't care who they are. The real gurus say, don't make me your guru. It's the Holy Spirit, the grace of God is your guru. Those are the real gurus. And believe it and pay attention to that. Because the treachery is off the charts. It's mind, it's doing it. Because again, Spirit told mind, I want to be prime creator. And show me the way. And so mind is saying, okay, you have to learn how to die, so here's how you do it. And so mind has to be present this totally treacherous scenario, you know, as a training exercise. And so mind is all creative, okay, and so it's able to just weave a story of treachery continuously in deception, extreme deception. It's able to do that, and we are, you know, vulnerable putty to that. We fall for it. So the Holy Spirit doesn't fall for it at all. The Holy Spirit does not fall for it, because God gave a creation specifically to deal with this situation, the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is totally wise to the whole thing and totally invulnerable to mind's deceptions as far as loss goes. This is a story of loss. Invulnerable to it. Is never tricked by it. So the Holy Spirit is the real guru. From the very beginning, it was created as the guru, as the grace to liberate us from this terrible deception that we're in. So again, you can benefit from what others say, but don't make them your guru. Don't make them your guru. The Holy Spirit is the guru. You can attend satsang, you can do all that stuff, but don't make them your guru. If you get a feel they want you to worship them or something, forget it. Don't do that. If you feel that they're just there, their presence is there as an encouraging you to pay attention to the Holy Spirit and clarify, then that's fine. But be careful. You should be working on your own content of seeing and seeing and seeing more and more clearly, more and more clearly. Keep working on it, keep working on it, keep working on it. See, I don't have a guru. I don't have a guru except for the Holy Spirit. That's it. When I try to make these other, you know, these ones my guru, that's when trouble has happened to me. Big trouble. And to Jesus' credit, Jesus has never tried to present himself to me as my guru, our teacher. Never, 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 never. He just says, work harder, work harder. The real guru says, just work harder. Just keep working at it. Keep working at it. You'll get it. Listen to the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit will help you. Just keep working at it. Those are the gurus. And of course, they also have chosen the simulation of no loss for themselves. They're not trying to figure out how to kill themselves. They're not trying. So give up your desire to expire. Give up your desire to inspire, which is again treachery. And give up your desire to expire. Give up your attempt to figure out how to die. You cannot. The mind can have bodies die in infinite ways, but that's only, bodies are just symbols. They're not spirits, so spirit's not dying at all. Spirit's never died. Spirit has never suffered any loss, none. Spirit is watching a movie where there's just infinite loss, but spirit has never suffered any loss. It's trying to figure out how to suffer loss. It can't. It's really perplexed, you know. Spirit is really frustrated. It says, I can't figure it out. And really, literally, your mind, I mean, your spirit right now is saying, as you go about your day, you're thinking, I'm very frustrated, I just can't figure it out, I can't figure it out. I'm missing it. That's because it's not there. You cannot find it because it's not there. Spirit cannot suffer loss. Of course it cannot figure it out. That's the underlying frustration, spirit. It's with us all the time. We're not even aware of it. And we plan all these plans. We do all these things. And they suffer loss. And we're looking at them saying, huh, how did that plant, you know, how did it do that? You know, how did all this stuff happen? How does my body get sick? How do I die? How, you know, where is this power coming from? You know, it's all imagination. It's the mind that's presenting all this. It's just, it's no power to it at all. So, disillusionment is difficult. And that's where I think it's possible to help others. I feel I can help that way. I can help and maybe encourage distancing, some way of distancing. I hope I can go somewhere and continue to broadcast and continue to do this and help people get a sense of distancing from you know, this world, from this loss-based training exercise we call the world. Help the world, help those who want help practice that. Distancing, getting distance from it. Be in a really super nice place where everything is very fine, very nice, and very peaceful. And don't follow all the news, the horrible stuff, etc. And at the same hand, avoid the treachery of setting up some ideal place in a treacherous manner. That's very important too. And continue exposing, bringing all this stuff to light. It's very helpful to bring this stuff to light. Whatever anyone wants to say about me, the fact is I have brought all this stuff up to light. I've been honest with all of it and brought it to light and shared it. So that cannot be taken away from me. I've actually done that. There's very few that are doing that. There's a few that have pointed out some of this treachery, really. That's super helpful, super helpful. Because you see others do it, you say, hey, I can do it too. Because eventually we all have to recognize that existence is entirely treacherous. And the purpose of existence is, again, to teach spirit how to die. That's what it's for. Now we can give a different purpose by choosing a different idea, different. So we don't want to be prime creator. We don't need to teach ourselves how to die then. So we can give it a different purpose. But until we do, it maintains the purpose that we have given it. And there's more that I could say for sure. More that I can say. And again, I'm fine, but there are those who are trying to convince me that I'm sick. And larynx-wise, I can't talk or something. They don't want me to keep talking. So it would be a good idea for me to get out of Dodge at some point. I don't have the means personally as far as it goes, because I did get caught up in this massive effort to build this principality, to provide right models and all this stuff. I have all the videotape and everything I did. It did so much. I spent so much. I completely wiped out my future in attempting this. And now I see it was all a scam. And so I don't have the means. At one level, I don't. But maybe I can get to see things differently, and then it will come to me in some way of how to do that, how to distance myself. Because a lot of people in the same boat, you know, they're figuring, how can I distance myself? There is some way to do it. I think the unified perspective of the unity perspective of nothing and everything. It would seem that would enable that take place. I got this feeling that would, from that perspective, there's you're able to move, because you're not seeing it as movement. It's different. From a standpoint of, for me, moving is impossible right now. I cannot. I'm stuck. But from the standpoint of this unity consciousness, not things unified, but one, intrinsically one. Nothing and everything is one. From that state of consciousness, you're not moving. You're not really going anywhere. So you're able to do it because it's not. You're not really doing anything from that standpoint. So it's and none of my mom's able to move everywhere and do anything. It always worked out just like miraculously. And she said, I'm not going anywhere. I'm not moving. I'm not doing anything. I'm not going anywhere. And so, what is there to work out? It's just everything just seems to just be as it needs to be. So it's a different consciousness. So from that standpoint, it seems that I could distance myself from the world. That we can, we're capable of that. Without that, it hasn't worked for me. It has not worked. I've not been able to find any way short of that unity consciousness, oneness, recognition of oneness, Anything short of that, I've not been able to move. Can't. Stuck in a bad place. Silicon Valley's a very bad place, as a matter of fact. If you want to know the truth, it is an extraordinarily bad place. It is 4D to the max. And they have their agenda, believe me. And they're not going to let anyone get in their way. They are not going to let anything get in their way. And they make their own rules. They do things the way they want to do them. And they don't brook any interference whatsoever. And I'm telling you, Silicon Valley, Bay Area of California is a very, very, very nasty place. For those who don't want the 4D the agenda and who want freedom, who want enlightenment, it's a very nasty place. A great place to be distanced from, that is for sure. So I look forward to the time when I can distance myself from this place. I've been here my entire life. I can't get out of the place. It's like I'm trapped. And from the standpoint of 4D, I am trapped. Because from that standpoint, I have to play by their rules, and they're not giving me permission to leave. And from the standpoint of 3D, I can't function. From the standpoint of 3D, because they're telling 3D what to do. Hi. Also. 1 second, please. Yeah. So,
no.
Yeah, I'll be right there. There has to be a way, and I believe that this recognizing that my identity is nothing and everything as one, both, nothing and everything, then gives an entirely different perspective to everything, what you're doing, and it doesn't seem like moving then. It's redefined, completely redefined in some other way that is somehow very liberating. Very, very liberating. And I believe that's the only solution to the situation, actually. So I'm looking forward to that liberation. So it won't be, again, it's all unresolved. You leave it unresolved. The 4D, 3D, can you move in 4D? Can you move? It's unresolved. You have to leave it unresolved. You didn't solve it at that level. You redefined it entirely. Where you're not moving because you're everywhere. You're everywhere and you're nowhere all at once, both. Right now, you're everywhere and you're nowhere. So, what is moving and where is movement? It's meaningless in that sense. It's meaningless. So you see it in a different way, and then you are able to distance yourself, as it were, from a situation that has the tendency to try and pull you away from clarity, you see. Yeah, all right. Let's all pray for this type of true enlightenment so that we can distance ourselves from what is trying to work, pull us into this black hole of loss. Spirit trying to train itself how to die. We don't want that anymore. All right? Very great. That's it for this one.